Tomorrow in the church calendar, we remember Matthias. Some people, far from remembering Matthias, have never heard of him at all. He's not the best known character in the Bible. But he was the one chosen to take over the place amongst the disciples, left vacant following the departure of Judas Iscariot. In the reading, we'll hear some words of Peter, who says that they must choose someone to join with them as a witness to the resurrection. It's a big task, and it reminds us as well that it is the task of all Christian people today to be witnesses in words and in actions to the resurrection of Jesus. The reading from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 1. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers, together the crowd numbered about 120 people, and said, "Friends, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit through David foretold concerning Judas, who became a guide for those who arrested Jesus. He was one of our number and shared in this ministry. Therefore, it is necessary to choose one of the men who have been with us the whole time the Lord Jesus was living among us, beginning from John's baptism to the time when Jesus was taken up from us. For one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection." So they nominated two men, Joseph called Barsabbas, also known as Justus, and Matthias. Then they prayed, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which of these two you have chosen to take over this apostolic ministry, which Judas left to go where he belongs." Then they cast lots, and the lot fell to Matthias. So he was added to the 11 apostles. Did you know that it was not until 1850 that the world population reached the 1 billion mark? By 1960, it reached 3 billion. By 1990, 5.2 billion. And now we've arrived at 7.8 billion. In the past 60 years, the world population is getting near to tripling. Or did you know that until the year 1800, the top speed was 20 miles an hour as people travelled on horseback? With the arrival of the train, almost overnight, we jumped to 100 miles per hour. By 1952, the first passenger jet could travel 500 miles an hour. In 1979, Concorde cruised at 1200 miles per hour. Change over the past couple of hundred years has been more rapid than at any other period in history. But no change has ever been as significant as the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus and the growth of the early church. The reading from Acts is very much concerned with this new church. As we all know, anything new takes time to work out properly, to work through the finer detail, to encourage wider participation, and to make sure that there's something new is something that's going to be good and useful. All those things were true of the early church. Think of the context, first of all. In a relatively short space of time, Jesus had begun his ministry. He transformed lives through his speaking and through the powers of healing and compassion. He'd given teaching to people about things unheard of at the time. Care for everyone, compassion, forgiveness, second chances, welcoming everyone, even those considered outcasts. Then he travelled to Jerusalem, and there he was condemned to death. But 3 days later conquered death forever, and appeared to his disciples and many others. Confident and inspired, they would go about being the body of Christ on earth, sharing his good news with everyone. Many heard, and again, in a relatively short time, the church grew and grew. In the reading, we were told Peter spoke up to the believers, and we're told that there were 120 of them. If there were more somewhere else, it probably wasn't many. But the power of God and the confidence of the faith of the early church was such that this small group was to grow into a church that would literally change the whole world. But again, we think of the beginnings of that church. We recall that following his betrayal of Jesus, Judas had killed himself, and it was decided that he should be replaced. And so two names were put forward, Joseph called Barsabbas, and Matthias. And as we read about the election of Judas' successor, our first thought will surely be how random it looks. There was no interview, no election campaign, no secret ballot, not even a show of hands. Instead, they prayed and cast lots, and Matthias became the 12th apostle. It's quite unlikely that in any serious contest today, we would just consider drawing lots to be a sensible option. But the early church perhaps were equally happy with either man, or perhaps were happy just to leave it in God's hands, trusting that he would give them the right answer. And so he thought a little bit about the growth of the early church, but the growth of the early church remains equally important to us today. Not for what it's ultimately become and as a way of looking back at our heritage, but as a way of learning some important lessons for today. The first is that the inspiration that drove the members of the early church must still be our inspiration today. Jesus risen and ascended for us. His life and his teaching must still be our motivation as we seek to share his good news. His courage and comfort must be our courage and comfort when we face problems in our lives, whatever they may be. His love must be the love that we respond to as we seek to share that love, just as he does. The second point is that we can also be inspired by what a small number of people can do with God's help. A small number of people built a church that today numbers something over 2 billion members. I, like many of you, I'm sure, wonder exactly what the church might look like once this current situation is over. When we will meet in church buildings again, when we'll sing hymns together. Will some of our church buildings ever open again, perhaps? Whatever the answers to those questions, we can be confident in the message of Jesus because his is a message that will make the world a better place. It's about eternal salvation, but it's also about peace in the world and in the hearts of people everywhere today. Who can look around the world today and say that we don't need a little more compassion, a little more love, a little more justice and peace, a little more hope? And the list of good things can go on and on and on. Jesus doesn't want us to have a little more of those things. He wants those things to reign, to be absolute within his kingdom, which will cover the whole earth. And the final point is that the selection of Matthias really does seem random. But the lesson it gives us is one that inspires us to think of what it means to completely put our trust and faith in God. Today, wherever we may be, and whatever buildings we're used to attending, or perhaps we don't usually attend any church building, may we be inspired to focus on Jesus, the example of perfect love, the giver of perfect peace, the way to eternal life. May we be inspired by what small numbers can do, knowing that with God all things are possible. And finally, may we pray that the Holy Spirit will fill us with more and more trust in God and in his love and his power and his protection and his peace. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we bring before you our prayers today and reflecting on your love for us and your presence with us. Inspire us as your people to focus more on your Son Jesus, to seek to love as he loves, to offer peace to others, just as we are offered peace through him. Inspire us also to remember that as your servants, we can be confident in your power to transform, to heal, to support. And so help us to be confident in seeking to share the good news of your love with others. And finally, Lord, we pray for all in special need of prayer at this time, thinking especially of those who are sick or suffering in any way, those caring for a loved one who is struggling, those in key professions who are doing so much to care for the needs of others in so many different ways. Bless each one of them, Lord, and make them constantly aware of your presence with them and your love for them. These and all our prayers we sum up in the words that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.